symptoms, which I do not, thankfully. But if I had symptoms, we would go to step one, and the first thing I would do is quarantine. I would decide to be at home following public health guidance to be there for 14 days and make sure that if I share the house with any family members, that I'm careful to keep some distance, that we disinfect and wash surfaces, that we really do try to keep a little more separate than we normally do. So if there's a risk that I am infected and my family member isn't, that they don't in fact get infected as well. And the second thing is we work to get me tested and we try to get that to be timely. That means that the specimen is collected in a timely way, that we get it to a lab that processes it, and that we get that information as quickly as possible so it's actionable. And then with that test result, let's say it is positive, then I go from what we talk about as quarantining to isolating. Very similar, remain at home for that 14 days, watch closely for the development of symptoms and make sure that I'm careful not to interact with anybody who's either known to be positive or has not been a close contact as of yet. And then I work with the public health officials in my community to begin identifying my close contacts. Obviously people who are living in my household, but then also for me, people that I work with, that I may be seeing on a regular basis in an indoor setting, even though I'm good at wearing my face covering when indoors and not alone, it's still very important that we identify those close contacts so they can also quarantine. And then with public health guidance and following our recently released testing priority list, that they may also need to be tested. And so the cycle goes so that we can identify those cases and make sure that we cut down those roads of transmission so that we reduce the number of cases ultimately in California, the number of people who become very sick from COVID, need care in the hospital, and God forbid, but that we prevent as many deaths as we can from COVID-19. So with that, I wanted to talk a little bit about case finding. This is the process of really identifying individuals who are COVID-19 positive. I know we haven't used this concept of case finding before, but it's a pretty simple one. It's just really using testing to allow us to identify those who are positive, and then using that information to corner the virus, limit the spread, and stop the outbreak, just like I showed on the previous slide. I wanted to take a moment and talk to you a little bit about what California has done in the context of the rest of the U.S. You'll see here that we've done just over 8.3 million tests in California of PCR tests. We've also done some antigen tests. We've done some antibody tests, but we're not counting that here. That roughly represents 14.4% of all tests in the United States. I'll remind you that we're about 12% of the U.S. population as a state. So the fact that we're testing at a percentage point higher than our total population percentage is one of our goals, and we're going to continue to build that testing capacity up. Cases identified, those are positive tests, just over 514,000, roughly just under 11% of all cases in the U.S. And then from our death numbers, 6.4% of all deaths from COVID-19 happened here in California. And so when you look at the numbers together, that 14.4 versus the 10.9 versus the 6.4, those are in a magnitude and directionality that's exactly what we want to see. We want to see increased number of tests, identification of cases so we can intervene at the local level, at the very personal level, like I walked through with my own experience if I were positive, and then ultimately a much lower percentage of the deaths. So this is exactly what we want to see. We know we can always make improvements in this, but certainly one of our key strategies. So case finding, as I said, or finding those positive cases is best done early. The earlier we find a case, the earlier we can act. And this is why we focus so much on test processing delays and getting our testing up to scale across the state. I'll remind you that just a few months ago, we were talking about under 2,000 tests a day being done throughout California. Today, we're consistently above 120,000 tests a day. We're working hard with our partners in labs across the state, across the nation, to make sure they have all the supplies, that we have the test collection sites, both in our hospitals, in our clinics, but also in our communities, in a mobile way, going to our workplaces, to our community centers, to potentially places of worship, to make sure that we increase our ability to have timely test results. We also are working to make sure that once we do have information on tests, that that data gets submitted from our laboratories to our public health departments, and ultimately to the state public health department, so we can bring it all together in one place on the California dashboards that many of you look at on our COVID-19.ca.gov site. This is important also to remind you that last week I had the privilege of announcing our improvement to data reporting around race and ethnicity, around sexual orientation and gender identity. All of that information helps support us doing better and improved understanding of where transmission is happening throughout the state, which populations it's affecting the most, and how to sharpen our efforts to reduce transmission, especially among those who are most disproportionately impacted. Then we have a pretty robust data entry and validation process. We want to make sure that we're not seeing duplication in test results, and that the data is as complete and clean as possible, so it is as actionable as possible. And then lastly, I want to mention system capacity challenges and opportunities. We know that we've done nothing like this response to COVID-19 before. Rarely do we have all test results reported. Often it's just the positive tests. And at this volume, we have not seen the scale. It certainly is testing our systems and its capacity. And in fact, over the past few days, the state system, we've discovered some discrepancies. We're working hard and immediately to reach out to the labs that we work with to get accurate information in a manual process, so we can feed that to our local county partners, that we can validate and make sure that our numbers are accurate. And then, of course, working hard on the technology side across state government to make sure that the CDPH systems are robust and capable of accepting all of this volume of information. I want to just spend another moment on this to remind you that because of these recent data issues, that reporting that some counties, many counties, in fact, depend on the state's information to keep their own data up to date, that many public health officials and public health offices that depend on the state's data over the past few days have seen a drop in their case numbers. They're concerned, just like we are. We've been in communication with them about what these discrepancies are, how we might help to improve them. But there is no doubt that their ability to address in a timely way specific cases around case investigation and contact tracing is limited. And so I just want to remind individuals who are watching that if you do have symptoms, if you are concerned that you were a close contact of somebody who is COVID-19 positive, please remember the slide I showed earlier. Begin your quarantine. Don't wait for your test. Act now so that we can reduce transmission across the state. We are working around the clock to make these improvements, but in the meantime, please remember that important message. I want to remind you, though, that these data challenges on the cases do not have overlap with our hospitalization and ICU numbers. Those are done in a separate way, that we continue to validate those with our local health leaders, our local hospital systems, and we feel confident that they are beginning to stabilize, as the governor mentioned yesterday, that we are seeing increasing reductions. Instead of a 10% reduction in hospitalizations yesterday, we're now down to an 11% reduction over the past 14 days. And similarly, our ICU admissions continue to reduce. That is good news, but it reminds us that we actually know what we can do in California to continue to bend this curve, to work together, to avoid some of the worst outcomes, some of the sickest situations that we see in the state. That all said, we continue to see hotspots in pockets of the state. This includes the Central Valley. The governor has shared the efforts on focusing not just with individuals from the state going to work hand in hand with our local partners in the Central Valley on everything from making sure the hospital capacity is strong enough to take care of those who are sick, to working with our employer and community partners to ensure that testing and public and good education and messaging on how to reduce risk and take care of yourself when you're sick is out in the public in abundance. So we continue to work in the Central Valley, and just like we saw in Imperial County, we expect over the next many weeks that we will see a trend down of those cases, improvements in the number of people in hospitals, and overall equipping yet another valuable and important part of the state in the Central Valley with the tools to continue to stay in front of COVID-19. So as always, we continue to learn. We continue to learn from the science. We continue to learn from our own data how to stop the spread. And it really does come down to a few simple acts that can make a big difference. Wearing a mask, and not just wearing it for a few minutes or a couple of hours. Sometimes it means wearing it for a little longer than you thought you would. Maintaining that 6 feet of distance or even more if possible. Washing our hands the right way, 20 seconds or more with soap, and when you don't have that, hand sanitizer. And then minimizing our mixing. I know this is a hard one, that people want to see many of our friends and families, and we encourage you to minimize that as much as possible because it does help us reduce transmission. So with that, I thank you again for joining us this afternoon, and I look forward to taking your questions.
Jim Root, Westwood One News.
Hi, thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Ghaly, for making yourself available again. We really appreciate this. In Southern California, there was a party, a mansion party, and in that mansion party was a shooting. Now, aside from that, there were some 200 people gathered there, and many of the shots from news choppers showed no physical distancing, no mask wearing. So you have a massive gathering of people not adhering to public health directives. My question is, and the LAPD said when they originally went on a nuisance call to that house, they just told everybody to go back inside and let the party go on, saying that they cannot enforce health officer orders in a private home. But in this particular situation with this, with COVID-19, isn't there a public risk with large gatherings? If I was in my house, my private home, firing a gun out the window, the police could definitely tell me to stop that because it's risking the public health. Why can't health officer orders be enforced that way with being able to shut down large gatherings when people leaving that house are a risk now to public health? I hope I articulated that well enough because it really is a very confusing thing. If you could help us, we really appreciate that.
Sure, Jim. First, thank you for the question. Absolutely. I just want to underscore that large gatherings of any kind really don't help us and really should be avoided. And I often talk about the sector of personal responsibility. We focused on sector guidance throughout our entire reopening process, whether it's about religious ceremonies or barber shops or restaurants. I like to think about our own activities as a sector, that there are guidelines about what we should do and how we should behave in our communities, and attending a large gathering certainly minimizes or really doesn't follow that sector of personal responsibility rule book. Obviously the physical distancing, it doesn't sound like it was a setting where there were face coverings or masks used. So all around, it sounds like a high risk experience for those who were there, and frankly, for the loved ones that they go home to. And even if they themselves aren't high risk for a bad outcome, if they were infected, they may in fact live with somebody, an older person that's in their house, a grandmother, an uncle, an aunt, a parent, or somebody who isn't even because of their age higher risk, but because of an underlying condition like diabetes or heart disease. So it sounds like a terribly risky situation. I hope that we continue to have our local partners not just saying and reminding people of the message, but enforcing public health orders, not just the state public health orders, but the orders at the local level that I know in LA County are strong as well. And so issues like the one you raised need to be addressed head on, and we depend on our local partners to enforce those public health orders throughout the state, throughout our communities, not because the state doesn't do it as well. We do our part, but it really is a local and an important local issue to see happening more and more across the state.
Amy Taxon, AP.
Thank you so much. I have a multi-part question. I'd like to see if you can answer, what is causing the problems in Calready, and how many tests roughly do you estimate are not being reported, and when do you expect to fix? I also like to know how this impacts your tracking of the virus and infection rates and the ability of county health officials to conduct contact tracing. And finally, yesterday, Governor Newsom said that the state has a 6.1% positivity rate over the past 7 days. Is that based on inaccurate data, and as a result, is it inaccurate?
So thank you, Amy, for your question. I'm gonna try to remember all of the parts. I think there were six, maybe even seven, so I'll try to go through each one of them. First off, the CalReady system has multiple components to it. There's a specific component that feeds information from labs to both the state system and the local public health system that may actually be the place where data is getting stuck. So we are working on that currently to try to understand in detail what that might be. We're not, we're certainly working around the clock. We're not sure when we will have a definitive fix to the problem. But in the meantime, as I mentioned earlier, we are working on parallel processes, manual processes, to get the same information that we would through the CalReady system back to local public health departments so that they can do what you raised in another part of your question, which is absolutely hampered without the data, without the power of that tool, which is data around who might be infected or who is infected, and then beginning the contact tracing process. So absolutely, it will be hindered without this information. And that's why, as we figure out the IT issues, we are in parallel working with our lab partners to get the same information in a manual form to local health officials, those who are doing contact tracing, so that we can begin to or continue to do that very important work and reduce transmission across the state. To your last set of questions, the 7-day positivity rate is absolutely affected by this. And as we continue to update the information, and I'm glad you raise it, we will certainly be updating the positivity rate on a daily basis as we do. And remember, we take into account not just one day, not just 7 days, but even 14 days, so that we make sure we're seeing the long trends and not just one-day snapshots. We often experience some lower than expected reporting. The governor says it often, the virus doesn't take the weekend off. We often don't see high numbers on Monday mornings because Sunday becomes a slower reporting day for a lot of operational issues. So we have weathered and gone through in other periods challenges with getting complete data, and that is in part why we look at that 7-day and that 14-day test positivity, and frankly, all numbers looked at over a course of 7 to 14 days. So we'll continue to use that as our guiding tool rather than the one-day snapshots that I don't want to minimize their importance, but it really is looking at our trends over time.
Alex Michelson, Fox 11.
Hi, Dr. Ghaly. Thank you for taking our questions. I want to follow up, if you would, on the party situation that was in LA County last night. Because for a lot of folks whose businesses were shut down, they look at a scene like that and they're frustrated because they did everything right. They still get shut down and they see something like that happening. I'm wondering what your message to some of those folks would be. And you said it's sort of up to the locals to enforce. What should be the protocol? Should the LAPD move in and break something like that up? What would your suggestion be from a state health perspective of what to do if they're presented with those situations, which unfortunately seem to be happening far and far too often.
Yeah, thanks for the question. As I said, I mean, there's absolutely no doubt that not only does an event, a large gathering at a house or anywhere, create a high risk for those individuals who attended, their immediate family, but it does put in jeopardy our entire strategy as a set of 40 million Californians, 10 million Angelenos, wherever your local community is, to really put and, you know, really bring down transmission rates across the state. So what I say to everybody is continue to do your part and continue to influence your friends and family to do theirs. And I hope anyone who knows somebody who attended a large gathering or themselves is considering that you'll think twice, that you'll decide that now isn't the time, and that we'll continue to work together to really reduce transmission so we can build towards a new modified sense of normal as we really bring transmission rates down. And in some of the places that were recent hotspots, current hotspots, this is very, very important. LA is included among those areas. As far as it goes with enforcement, I think these are local conversations. The state is urging locals to use all of their tools to enforce. I think conversations between law enforcement jurisdictions across LA County, you know, there's many cities, many independent law enforcement agencies. You have the LA County Sheriff, you have many local leaders who can support that enforcement, that I think there's an opportunity here to talk through at the local level how to best do that, how to support communities while also delivering strong public health messaging. And I certainly, as an individual, as a resident of Los Angeles County, hope to see that done and done in a complete way.
Tiffany Stecker, Bloomberg.
Thanks, Senator Ghaly. Six states today announced they were entering a compact to bring rapid point-of-care testing to their states. I think this is being done through the National Governors Association and other organizations. I wanted to see if California is planning to, if there's any talk of California joining compact, and if there's maybe going to be a separate regional compact to increase the number of point-of-care.
Sure, Tiffany, thank you for the question. I'll just say that testing task force in California, which recently brought together two new co-chairs, is constantly looking at innovations in testing. We're looking at everything the governor has talked about, pool testing. We're talking about rapid turnaround point of care tests, understanding how antigen and antibody versus our PCR tests all fit together to really bring a robust plan to California. We're building up all of these opportunities. We have a number of folks on our team that are exploring point of care modalities. We want to make sure that whatever test approach we take and introduce in California, that it is not just very reliable, that it can be scaled, that we are confident in our ability to support the supply chain. You've heard about reagents and kits and instruments. We want to make sure all of those are together. So whenever we do introduce new modalities, that they really serve the need of such a large state like California. I will say that we're working hard on those traditional modalities now to improve turnaround time. And in some conversations with others, learning from other states, we are not yet entered into a multi-state effort to bring point of care testing, but we're always looking for opportunities to improve our position and make sure that we're bringing the latest and greatest to California so that we can get that timely information. And I would just remind people that the real advantage of point of care testing is that rapid turnaround time, that immediate information. So not only can we understand if somebody is really sick, if it's a COVID-19 infection and how to treat you while you're potentially in the hospital, but also helps us corner the virus, as we talked about earlier, help people quarantine and isolate with the right level of information, do that contact tracing, and work with our close contacts so they do the same. I think it's all very important. So we look forward to those new modalities being introduced at scale in California.
Bethany Elam, CNN.
Hi, Dr. Ghaly. I have a question for you about the strike teams or the support teams. I just wanted to know more information about
how they're working, how many people are going into the Central Valley, how long they'll be there, if there's different departments from California that are part of this, and then ultimately, which department is actually going to head up these strike teams? Thank you.
Yeah, so thank you for the question. I mean, we are, like I said, we learned a lot in Imperial County. We learned that multi-agencies across the state, led by our California Operation of Emergency Services, Director Ghilarducci's team, really spearheading the effort, bringing together my agency, multiple departments, California Department of Public Health, California Department on Aging, California Department on Social Services, to talk about not just the public health side, but the housing side issues for older individuals in the Central Valley, working close with our labor partners, our Cal-OSHA partners, our business partners, other entities that are working on housing, our ag department and agency that thinks about farm worker housing issues in the that are specific for farm workers, our departments and divisions that work with licensing of healthcare facilities, both skilled nursing facilities and hospitals, the Emergency Medical Services Agency in Health and Human Services, my agency, who work on bringing together the resources to make sure that care in hospitals happens well. So all of these entities, I think, I don't know the exact number, whether it's 7 or 10, but many people at the state have been on the ground. In fact, they're on the ground now in Central Valley, touching Fresno and Kern and Stanislaus and soon Merced and Madera and San Joaquin and others all together. We will be there for a number of weeks. I don't want to give a commitment, but I think somewhere between 4 to 8 weeks, we saw that as the right level of engagement in Imperial. We expect to do the same thing in the Central Valley, focused on both all of the aspects of making sure we reduce transmission, but also on the other hand, that our systems are prepared to take care of people who are sick, and increasingly focused on making sure our message is reaching the citizens of the Central Valley, that it's in language, that improving not just having it in English, but in Spanish, and making sure that it is touching a number of individuals' lives.
Paul Rogers, San Jose Mercury News.
Yeah, thanks, Doctor. You mentioned earlier a second or third wave in California. Can you talk a little bit about what you expect that to look like, when it is likely to start, and how it might compare to what we've seen so far in terms of cases and deaths?
Yeah, it's an excellent question. I mean, we really don't know. I mean, what we know is we are more prepared than we ever have been. Right, we're ready on a number of levels. People talk, and many experts in our team tends to agree that we may see something in the fall. And I'll remind you, the concern isn't just COVID in the fall, but it's flu in the fall. And really preparing to respond to two mighty infectious diseases at the same time put us in an even more challenging position. And that's exactly why we've spent months preparing. I wish I could tell you what the magnitude would be. I just know that we are more ready, and that as we have our ability to test and do the disease investigation and the contact tracing, and we've deepened our message, and hopefully through all of you and, you know, all 40 million Californians get that message across loud and clear, that we can, without having the same level of increase, we can flatten it first time and do it successfully. So we not only avoid illness, but we avoid a number of deaths as well.
Final question, Nicole Nixon, Capital Public Radio.
Hi, Dr. Ghaly. Just a few questions about these new school waivers. Over the summer, there were quite a few reports of outbreaks at daycares and summer camps across the country. Just wondering what you learned from those situations to work into these waiver guidelines to try to prevent outbreaks happening in classes here. And then also, these waivers call for small cohorts. Just wondering what small is. Is there a number you tap that out, and who decides that?
So the first part of your question, we've absolutely been learning about transmission in all populations, and young people in particular. Some of the outbreaks you mentioned, You know, when you dig into the details, you see some of the opportunities for improvement and how you set up your own systems. And that's why we study them so closely. You see when activities are held indoors without face coverings, when activities that are much better done outdoors, no doubt, or avoided at all, happen indoors. You see transmission, things like chanting and singing and things that we all enjoy to do at our summer camps. That the use, again, I'll just remind you, the use of face coverings, the use of keeping some distance as much as possible, minimizing mixing among groups, that cohort size, frankly, smaller is better. Hopefully 4-8 people big is sort of the size that we look for. But we know that each school district is going to work with their local public health officials, with parents, with teachers, with other school professionals, with their community groups, to really make a decision on how they can move forward in a lower risk way. And because schools are not just a vital place of learning, they're vital community centers. It's where people rally and come together. Bringing in-person education and instruction is, of course, one of our key goals in California. But as the governor has said, and as we've tried to communicate through this waiver process, we will only do it when we can assure that we've created a lower risk environment for spread of COVID, that people are protected and that their safety and health comes first. So as we balance that, we're looking forward to our dialogue with a number of the local entities, both on the public health side and on the education side. And as we continue to improve the situation across California with transmission, as we stick to our basic lessons, those key reminders of wearing your mask, staying physically distanced, washing your hands, and minimizing mixing, that we can create an environment of disease transmission in our communities that is lower, that will allow schools to put those thoughtful plans into place. So with that, I just want to thank you again, as always, for joining us, for your questions. And as always, we look forward to working with every single one of you in California to bend the curve, to stop the spread, and return to some modified sense of normal as soon as we're able to. So until later, thank you very much and have a good afternoon.